These people have worked day in and day out. They have to continue working in the future, in the days ahead. Because just to say that the coronavirus will get over in a few days may not be a correct appreciation. The corona warriors who are in the front line need to remain motivated. They must have sufficient fervor in them to go on. And for that, we felt that if we as the armed forces can do something to motivate them, to keep them rejuvenated, what is it that we can do? And the little that we could do is give them the support. We do know how to motivate people because we constantly motivate our soldiers. And so there are various mechanisms that we employ. So I think we took a collective decision that this kind of a display could possibly help in raising the morale of our corona warriors to keep them motivated and keep them going.
And the armed forces stands ready at any time to step in, you know, when they are required. You're already producing, the DRDO is producing PPEs. I mean, I'm sure the army is ready to build a field hospital if necessary. So the army stands ready in case, you know, they are required to do more, sir.
Yes, we are working with the other government agencies, particularly in sync with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, because they are the ones who are actually leading the fight. And they keep giving us guidelines, they keep giving us some kind of an assessment as to what is likely to happen in the future. And keeping that in mind, we are preparing ourselves. We have prepared a number of isolation and quarantine facilities, we have created special hospitals for treating COVID patients in the northern region, southern, eastern, western, and central India. We are constantly upgrading our facilities, and let me assure you that even at the cost of inconveniencing our own soldiers, sailors, and airmen, we will make sure that we provide adequate support to our people, to our citizens, depending on what kind of support they need. We will continue revving up our procedures, continue increasing our capacities in sync with the other agencies of the government.
This also comes at a time when, you know, I mean, the whole world is at a standstill, and we can see that, you know, a virus can bring the world to a standstill. And in the realm of asymmetric warfare, you know, some non-state actors, some other characters may decide, you know, that this is a form of warfare that can be, you know, thrust upon the world in a sense, because we've seen the results. To what extent, you know, is are the defense forces, you know, evaluating these kind of concerns?
Training for CBRN, where B stands for biological warfare, is an activity we carry out regularly from time to time. Our soldiers are taught how to operate in such an environment. We also maintain some kind of special equipment and kits for some specialized units to operate in this environment. We also have some protective measures in place. But yes, a virus of this kind can emanate any time. And I think it is high time that we start doing studies on developing, agencies and institutes which can study the effect of such viruses to prevent the security forces from getting affected. Yes, it is a real threat, and we must prepare for this in the future.
Talking about that, sir, because the security forces, if they do get affected, I mean, even, you know, because we all have to maintain social distancing, it must be hard, you know, for the armed forces who are battle ready to, who are ready to, you know, go out and fight at any time, to suddenly start maintaining some restrictions to keep a potential virus out.
Well, social distancing is something which is very akin to what we do in combat. We also maintain some kind of a distance whenever you go into combat. You never give the adversary a concentrated force which he can take on in one go. So this kind of social distancing that we are talking about is part of our drill. So it doesn't affect our basic tactics of operation wherever we have to go. Yes, when we are collectively involved in an engagement or collectively carrying out some activity, particularly when it is a training activity or a seminar or a discussion, there it becomes a little difficult, but we'll have to now start modifying our drills. But operationally, I don't think social distancing, distancing will in any way affect our operational procedures, because our tactics is such that you have to maintain such distances even when you go for offensive or defensive operations.
There are, you know, concerns that this particular virus itself could have been, you know, a form of biological weapon. But, you know, it looks natural. That's even the scientists say so. But, you know, if that is a concern, I mean, if such thing can happen in the future, what sort of collaborations do countries have, you know, in terms of dealing with something like that?
Well, I'm sure there'll be some kind of consensus which will come out from amongst the international community. You know, it's like you have some restrictions on various kind of weapons of warfare that can be used. We're quite sure some kinds of convention will emerge through consensus as to whether this kind of a virus can be used as a weapon in war. So we're quite hopeful that the international community will certainly take care of this, and we will see some guidelines coming out in the future.
Right. Final question. Now, we are in, there are some conflict zones that we are already involved with. And, you know, because perhaps our attention is spanned elsewhere, there may be, you know, a spike in activity. We are always ready, right, to fight anything. That's the kind of, that's the impression that one gets. Is that the case, sir?
Nowhere are we lowering our guard from our primary task. Troops are deployed in as much as we want them to be ready, in the Western Front, on the Northern Front. The pilots required to fly the aircraft very much continuing with the training effort. The ships and submarines are being manned to the minimum preparatory level that we expect them to be in. So I don't think operationally in any way we are getting affected. Yes, we have some peacetime units which are involved in supporting the government in maintaining facilities for the coronavirus patients and those who are getting affected by this. But these are far and few in between. We've got enough troops in the rear areas. I'm quite sure if something happens, we will be able to move these people on the front line if required, and then collaborate with the local Central Armed Police Forces and see how we can manage these facilities. I think we can do both together.
Right. The next stage of this battle, sir, is economic. The armed forces, do they have a role to play if called upon?
The people of the nation have understood that this is a crisis which is not only affecting India, it is affecting the world. And every country in this world has been affected. So yes, there are some job losses. There is some downsizing happening elsewhere. There are some pay cuts happening, I'm told, in some institutions. But the people do understand that in such times of crisis, the nation has always stood together. And we are quite confident. We don't visualize any kind of trouble happening because, you know, it's like whenever we've had a war in our country, we've seen